I've organized my session today around 6 questions. Some of these seem basic, but there's more than one answer to some of them. The first one is, what is inclusion? Where is inclusive reform initiated and supported? Why is principal leadership so important? I'll spend most of my time on what do inclusive principals do, what we know about their preparation for inclusive schools, and what you may be most interested in is there's quite a few resources available for people who are interested in this work. And I'm going to draw on 30 studies that I reviewed about the work of inclusive schools and districts over the last 20 years. You know, there's only been 30 studies done in 30 years. That's not a lot. But there's some pretty clear patterns in those findings. So what is inclusion? One is, there's no official definition. It's not in the law, and people approach this really differently. I'm taking a very pragmatic definition today. The things that people need to think about as they create and support inclusive schools. Often we talk about physical placement in inclusive schools and classrooms, and sometimes the conversation stops there. But as important is that students need to feel like they are valued members of those classes, that they're part of classroom routines and activities, and that students have relevant other kinds of experiences. They have the same choices that other students have, and they get to form interpersonal relationships. Another thing we talk about a fair amount in our field is that the general education curriculum must be accessible to students with disabilities, and that we provide that curriculum with whatever it takes for students to learn. So inclusion can't be just one of these things. It has to be really all three of these things. And that's a complete way of thinking about the student in the class learning with other students. In the studies of inclusive schools, they vary. Some people are moving from segregated schools into resource classrooms. Others are moving from self-contained or resource classrooms into full inclusion. So the studies vary. But in general, people are working to make their school more inclusive than they've been in the past. Another thing is, who initiates inclusive reform? And across these 30 studies, we saw districts and parents often being the ones. If we wait for school leaders to do it, they may or may not. They're busy people. They have a lot to do. They may not want to add it to their plate. So sometimes having people come from the outside, sometimes from the district, the Office of Special Education in past years has provided money to states. States can provide incentives, professional development. University people sometimes go to districts and say, I'd like to work on the school being more inclusive. And in some, not very many, courts have mandated greater inclusion. But somebody has to take responsibility, and it's usually somebody who cares about inclusion and is committed to it. It's important that it gets started. And so I think people have to think about where it gets started. So why is principal leadership important? Salisbury, who studied inclusive schools, says, schools that function inclusively do so for a reason, and the principals in these schools are the reason. Because principals play critical roles in creating a culture and support. And across all of these 30 studies, almost always when principals are really working and they were committed, the schools became committed. And the contrast is also true. When principals were half-hearted or didn't really put a lot of effort into it, it tended to languish. So the knowledge base about what principals do could be summarized in quite a few details, but I'm going to give you 8 ideas that come from this literature. Principals work to support a shared vision for inclusion and articulate this support to very constituents like parents and other teachers and anybody that really came in contact with the school. And they worked to help others see why inclusion was important. The key word here in the first one is shared. It's so important how principals work to get other support for that inclusive vision. It often took sometimes a year or more in some cases for people to really kind of have an understanding of what was meant. So they really worked to buy in from others, they visited other schools, and they provided lots of opportunities for discussion. Sometimes principals brought it up by talking about where they were in terms of inclusion. We have a lot of separate classes. Our students aren't achieving as much as we hope they will. So maybe we need to give them more opportunities to access that curriculum in general education classrooms. A second thing principals do is they foster a culture of high expectations for students with disabilities, as well as collective responsibility. Sometimes principals have to challenge others to realize that maybe people have lower expectations than they need to for students with disabilities, and there's a historical and institutional context for those low expectations. So sometimes they have to kind of probe and push and get people to say, maybe students can do more than we think they can, because low expectations are really a barrier to kids learning. Another thing they do is they work to help others say that we all, everybody, every person in this school has a responsibility for educating students with disabilities or supporting those students. And to realize this is not special education thing to do. It's all of our work, and we work together to make that happen. One of the first things principals did in these successful inclusive schools was share decision-making with others. This was in almost every successful effort. They would seek first broad input from everyone in that school, but they often had planning teams. Teachers often created the plan for inclusion in that school, not the principal. They worked with the principal. The teachers often took ownership for this effort. They often had teacher leaders, parents, critical friends, and those critical friends were sometimes university people, a retired leader who had been involved in a successful inclusive effort, to ask questions, to give them feedback, and to kind of support that effort. So in one example, Constantine O'Harris talked about in one school that the teachers, the teacher planning team, they drew out what the current environment was like for students with disabilities. And then they created a new picture of what it could look like. The contrast there gave people to think about, is this the direction we want to go? How might we revise this plan? But again, teachers really had a lot to do with making this happen. The fourth one is supporting teacher learning. If you look at the literature on general educators' preparation to teach kids with disabilities, many teachers say that they don't feel fully prepared for this work. And so they need to get a sense, not just sort of the definition of a solution, but what might it look like in my class? How am I going to teach these students? And they often had formal PD from states or districts about differentiation, collaboration, adaptations, behavior, and that helped them get started. But it was the informal work in these schools that really made the difference. Some describe professional learning communities. McCluskey and colleagues talk about that. The Matthews talked about how one principal used teacher discussion and work together as the primary tool to discuss students, to problem solve, and to share ideas and strategies. Clearly, the PD piece is important for increasing the capacity of staff in that school to make a difference. They also created working conditions and structures that supported inclusion. For example, they would change teachers' roles, talking about how all of the special education teachers in one school were assigned to grade level teams, and they were referred to by grade level, no longer special education teachers. They were trying to reduce the barriers between general and special education. They would create schedules that allow special education teachers, say, to work on reading during a particular period of the day. So they would have block scheduling so everybody worked in the school at the same time, so the special education teachers could use those evidence-based practices to teach those students. Another thing that they did was scheduling time for collaboration and making sure that general education teachers had resources in those schools. A sixth one was they monitored progress, and they would monitor progress toward inclusion. Some of the schools looked at how much more inclusive are we based on that physical placement. Many looked at student progress with RTI or NTSS systems. In addition, some took how did the students do last year with their grades and scores when they were in a more restrictive setting, comparing that to the present day. So they figured out different ways to do that. And as they progress monitored, they would problem solve and say, we have a problem here. Let's work on this particular student and figure out how we're going to make it work. But they also took time to celebrate successes. Very few studies plan for sustaining inclusion over time. However, one study, Diane Rinzak, in working with Florida, they looked over a 7-year period the extent to which inclusion was sustained, and they showed that indeed it could be making sure they're bringing people into the system that support it, and also providing PD to new hires. And the final thing is that throughout this process, principals learn to encourage questions, they learn to accept resistance because they almost always encountered some resistance. And they tried to work through with individuals who didn't want to do inclusion. Sometimes they provided coaching to these individuals. Sometimes a few individuals remained pretty adamant. But in the more recent studies, principals have taken the position of inclusion is a non-negotiable. How we do it is quite negotiable. And I want you to have a lot of input into how it works. What do we know about principals and their preparation for inclusive schools? The literature that we have says that oftentimes the legal aspects of special education are what is emphasized. And sometimes principals often, I would say, have minimal preparation about inclusion and effective programs. And some of them are really unclear about what special education is designed to do. And some are concerned about general education's readiness to teach some students. So there's a lot of work to do in preparing principals for an inclusive school. And so lots of times principals participated in PD along with teachers, and there was work from the district to get principals ready for this work. There are a range of resources that are available to support leadership development. And this might be professional learning, because we know principals need PD, coursework, micro-credentialing, or even self-study. And there's many free web-based resources that are high quality that they might go to. One of my favorite things is going to the guidance document developed by CCSSO and CEDAR on inclusive leadership. For the first time, we have guidance about inclusive leadership in schools tied to the 10 standards that are used for leader development and leader practice. And so I think that's very exciting. This document outlines in detail what inclusive principles do, and it provides a lot of guidance in terms of what to work toward. There's also CEDAR principles resources. There's a monograph that you can download. We also have the STEM, which is a course enhancement module that provides a syllabus, 7 lectures of activities, and resources for 21 hours of instruction on inclusive education. This can be taken, modified, adapted for use in one's own context. To tell you about some additional resources that you might want to include as you develop a course. The SWIFT Schools is a wonderful resource with a lot of high-quality resources for leaders and those working in inclusive schools. They have many podcasts, webinars, videos, tools. It's really a go-to resource as you're thinking about inclusion. And it gets very specific about things that can be done. The IRIS resources, they have 17 modules on school improvement and leadership. There's one on differentiated instruction, maximizing the learning of all students. The most recent one is one on IEPs, but there's many more. You just have to go to the search tool and put in school leadership and improvement, and these 17 resources plus some others will also come up. I also want to mention that I think one of the best ways to learn about what inclusive school leadership looks like is to look at the case studies of what leaders did in actual context. So, for example, there are articles that describe what state and district leaders did, what exemplary principals in pre-K or elementary schools did in creating a school. There are fewer examples in secondary schools. And there also are examples of inclusive efforts that were sustained, were not, over time. And there's also examples of stalled or failed efforts. All of these provide fodder for discussion and thinking through different contexts, both urban and suburban. Also, James McCluskey has a handbook of effective and inclusive schools if you want a scholarly tome. Cost and Theo Harris has a great book on a very practitioner-oriented book. There's also a handbook on leadership administration for special ed that has material on inclusion.